introduce our guest speaker because you all had to look at her LinkedIn page, right? And it is like the best LinkedIn page in the world, although apparently her son's LinkedIn pages are actually quite good. They're at a different college. But it's not UCLA, so it's okay. Pat Wadors is the SVP for Global Talent Management at LinkedIn. She's got an amazing array of ideas, perspectives on companies, on millennials, on how you job hunt, on almost anything you could think about. And so it's open season between now and 10 to 5. So with that, Pat Wadors, be good.
Don't be good. Don't be good. So I'm actually, thank you guys for welcoming me to the school today. I appreciate it. I enjoy the stuff a lot. My kids are kind of jealous I'm talking to you. They go, why don't you come to our school? And I go, you'd mock me and throw things at me. My kids, I never take them to work with me. They'll never work for me because they just take advantage of it.
I'm just gonna put this
thank you.
There.
Oh, I appreciate it. So I thought I'd just kind of riff on a few things and then open up to you guys for questions, all right? I love a dialogue, absolutely love millennials. I think that you guys are going to change the world, not only for today, but in the future. The world is different because you exist. I know that because I hire you, I pay you, I work on your training and development. I see how you get promoted. I see how you challenge me and debate things that no one ever debated before. The questions that are posed by this generation is making us pause. You don't accept things that our prior generations have accepted. So let's take equality as an example. In the world today, if you look at jobs, how many of you guys have interviewed for internships? Raise your hand. All right. When you look at jobs, how many people are worried about equal pay from a gender perspective? Raise your hands. Yeah, that was a big deal with my generation. Fair pay is a huge deal. There's data upon data that shows the lag in gender in terms of actual pay. For the same job, depending on the survey that you look at, there's anywhere between 15 to 20 cents differential between men and women in the workplace for the same job. And the reason why that exists, and there's a very big gender issue, women tend not to negotiate or sell themselves as hard as men do. That's a fact. Doesn't mean you deserve any less, right? But what's funny about your generation is that you don't rely on the negotiation to set up your value. You talk via social media, peer-to-peer, in the quad. What did you get paid for that job? I should get that same exact pay. I'm doing the same job, and it's an expectation of right. Never before have these conversations had such a public way. In the past, we would tell my job, head of HR would say, don't talk about your comp, it's private. It's a secret, don't talk about it. Now on Glassdoor and other vehicles out there in the marketplace, you can see someone's compensation posted in the world for everyone to see. That's because of this generation. So you're changing a lot of things as I live and breathe, which is really freaking cool for me and also a challenge for me because I never thought of some things that you've asked me in the past. My job has not been a simple path, it's been a fun path. So I have been in HR roughly, I won't even say 30 years. So 25 years in HR, maybe 6-7 years outside of HR. I knew at age 20 where I wanted to go and what I wanted to be. That is extremely odd. And when people say, my parents say, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I coach students and millennials in my office. Don't ask that question of your student and your child. It's not a destination that you should be worried about, it's the journey you should care and nurture. My best advice I had in my career came from my uncle. And he taught me that the first decade of your employment is like backpacking through Europe. Every country you visit, every family you live with, every person you have a beer with, you are learning something about culture, about society, about history that you will take forward in your life forevermore. Every country I've ever visited, I've been better for. I've had better contacts, better appreciation for cultural differences. I've learned to slow down and listen. I've learned to respect different religions. So your education through life, your degree, is one step. But the next job and the next job are other steps in which you spring from. So I don't tell my boys who are in college, what are you going to be when you grow up? I tell you, I want you to be a very happy, healthy human being that enjoys life to its fullest and brings me grandbabies at some point when you're old enough. That's all I say. And be good to others. I want you to enjoy life. And if you do that, you'll be wildly successful. So my first 10 years of my career, I went and built the platform of what I wanted to be. So I went 3 years in compensation. I went 2-3 years in recruiting, so I wanted to understand talent and recruit great talent. I did employee relations. I kind of did a rotation in the virtual world of HR. And then when I was 29, I said, look, I think I'm really good at HR, but I'm not sure if I understand business. I really cared about how companies make money. I care how you go to market. I wanted to learn. And I was at the time with a company called Merck Pharmaceutical, and they just acquired Medco. Medco is where I was from. Medco was a mail order pharmacy benefit company. It was based in New Jersey. It was throughout the United States. It was a really cool company, really kind of small and funky. And naively and innocently, I went to the head of sales for Merck, this huge company. I said, hey, I want to leave HR. I want to go into sales. And he was like, pat me on my little head, and he goes, that's nice. And I go, yeah, I want to learn business. You know, I care. I want to understand the revenue. I want to understand the cadence of the company. It's different than what I've experienced. I think it'd be a fun ride. And he goes, okay, well, are you a pharmacist? And I said, no. Any science background? No. Nothing? Sales? Anything? And I go, no. Well, retail, I sold clothes in high school. Does that count? He goes, no, not really. And I said, well, then no, I don't have prior skills. But you know, I really want to do this. I really want to work for Merck Pharmaceutical in sales. And he goes, well, why don't you think about it and I'll think about it and we could talk another day. And I go, fine. So I walked away, and it was probably like about 3 p.m. when I talked to him. I showed up bright and early at 8:15 the next morning because I thought about it that night. How much time do you need to think? For me, it's a night. Still thought about it. I still want to work for you in sales, Jim. And his admin tried to push me away out of his office, like, did you have an appointment? I'm like, no. I felt like I was being interviewed again. No, I don't belong here. I'm not in sales. Jim's not expecting me, but I really want to close this deal. And so Jim's laughing because he was just coming in with his coffee. I said, Jim, it's me again. And I said, I thought about it, and yeah, I still want to work for you in sales. And he goes, all right, that was quick. And he goes, so Pat, why do I want you? You forgot the sell. I go, oh, that's right. You know, so what's in it for me? Why do I want you? And I said, Jim, you don't want me. You need me. I forgot to tell you. I thought it was obvious. And he goes, well, why do I need you, Pat? And I go, well, Jim, look what you just acquired. And he goes, what did I acquire, Pat? And I said, a mail order pharmacy benefit plan, underlying benefit plan. Who do you sell to now? Doctors for your drug distribution. Through this acquisition, you're going to sell to geeks like me, HR people. I buy the benefit plan. I implement the benefit plan. My employees trust me because of who I am. You as a salesperson, not so much. So you need me. I will teach your team how to sell to geeks like me. And in turn, you will teach me the language of business, the cadence, and how you make money. Deal? And he goes, wow. He goes, close your eyes. And I'm like, now he's a dirty old man. So now I got worried. I'm like, me alone with an old man is not a good thing. But I closed my eyes anyway. I was 28. Like, what else? You know, I'll take a chance. And then he goes, and I'm hearing my dad in my head, like, don't do it, honey. And then he goes, all right, now point down. Now it got worse. I'm like, really? And so I point down, and it's on his desk, and I open up my eyes, because now I got really nervous, and it was a map of the United States. I just landed on LA, and he goes, how serious are you? And I said, extremely serious. And he goes, I need you in LA in 2 days. What do you think I did? Went to LA. I canceled my lease, broke up with my boyfriend, and called my dad, all within the hour. I wanted to learn. I am so curious all the time. That curiosity has driven me through fear. I have fear all the time. I make mistakes daily. I forget things. I'm like, oh shoot, I should have put that on my list. But my curiosity has brought me where I am today. So when you think about your career path and you think about what's driving you, you don't have to go a singular path. After I did sales for 3 years, during that time in LA, I met my husband, had my first kid. I don't do things slowly. And he was working for Merrill Lynch. I'm loving, you know, Merck. I got promoted, so I'm like, yay, I'm really good at sales. I'm really awesome. And I'm all of 30, really old. And my husband got promoted at Merrill Lynch. He was going to be a 401k marketing manager, like a retirement plan. Sounded boring to me. And but his job was up in the Bay Area, and I was down in LA. And then Merck was making me a job offer promotion, and my promotion would have taken me to Dallas or Ohio. So we both got promoted within 24 hours. And I freaked. I'm like, what do you do? Like, as a woman, you can't say his job's more important than mine. That would just piss me off, right? I'm still hormonal from the baby. Like, you don't want me mad. You don't want me mad. And so what happened, he came home, and I had a bottle of wine. I'm not condoning alcohol by any stretch, but I had a bottle of wine, two glasses and a quarter, and we flipped for it. Seriously, flipped for it. And he was like, no, don't you want to have a conversation? And I said, no. He goes, why not? I said, because Merrill Lynch is an amazing company with a great opportunity for your career, and you're an amazing human being. I turn over here, and Merck Pharmaceuticals is an amazing company, and bet on me, and wherever they take me would be an amazing journey, correct? He goes, right. I said, so both sides of this coin is a win, if you believe it. So let the coin decide where we go. And we did. So I quit Merck, followed my husband up to the Bay Area to Merrill Lynch. And what I told him, again, curiosity. Silicon Valley was known even when I lived in New York. I'm like, if you can do New York, you can make it anywhere song. Well, if you did HR in Silicon Valley, you can do HR anywhere in the world, because it's crazy up there. So I told him, I said, you can work in the city in San Francisco, but let me find a job in Silicon Valley. I'll go back into core HR, and let me take this ride. And he goes, done deal. I love what I do. Within 2 years of making that decision, my husband quit his job and has raised the family for us so I could pursue my dreams. Yeah, bravo to him. Thank you. Thank you. He's a godsend. He's a godsend. And because you clapped, I'll tell you this one funny story. So I'm at Applied Materials Semiconductor, really tough industry, going ups and downs. I'm supporting manufacturing. It's really hard, but I'm loving my life. And yeah, only had the one kid at the time. I'm just counting my kids in my head. No, I had two kids. I had two kids by then. I had two boys. And so my husband calls me up. Both boys are in diapers. And he calls me up for lunch from the city. And I go, no, we're not having lunch. And he goes, why? And I said, because we never have lunch. You're cheating on me. Just tell me what's going on. And he goes, no, I want to have lunch with you. I'm like, I can't eat now. I'm going to get sick. Just tell me what it is over the phone. He goes, honey, I'm coming down right down the street. I'm like, all right, you're going to get killed in public. So he shows up at Applied Materials in the parking lot. I'm like, all right, let's do it in the parking lot right now. You and me have it. And he goes, tell me. He goes, no, I want to have lunch with you. I'm like, okay. I go in the cafeteria with him. I don't remember what's on my plate. I go, honey, tell me. He goes, I quit my job, for God's sakes. And I go, okay, that's good. I painted the worst case scenario. And then I paused. I go, what do you mean? Why did you quit your job? We just got a house. I have two kids. Oh, my God, what's wrong with you? And he goes, honey, you love what you do. You wake up every day excited because the world is different every day for you. I've never seen that in anyone else. And he goes, and I want to raise the kids with you. And if we're both gone and working so hard, that's a juggle that I think we're going to have to try out. So I'll do a year with the kids. You fly, and we'll see how this works. Now, my oldest is 21 and a half. He's been helping my children become great adults. I have a special needs daughter that he's there along the way, the entire way with me. And we make this balance work. But my curiosity is what keeps me, you know, propelling to the future. Every job change, if you've seen my profile, is a different industry. My only repeat industry is internet, and that was Yahoo, where I met Jeff Weiner, who's now the CEO of LinkedIn, who brought me to LinkedIn. Curiosity. I've jumped in and out of HR 3 times. I want to learn how to do legal integration. I wanted to do change management, implement an Oracle system. I wanted to do sales at Merck. I want to learn. And in that journey of learning, I looked up and around and I found amazing people that I just adored for different reasons. Someone that I adored because how they stood up on a stage and talked, because I'm an introvert. I'm like, how do you do that? I know you're a quiet human being in a small team, but when you get up there, I just want to follow you around the world and back again. How do you do that? Then I met another person who analytical skills blew my mind. I'm not great with numbers. And he goes, yes, you are. And he goes, you're great with a story. Numbers tell stories. I'll show you how. And each person on my journey of curiosity, I found a nugget here, a nugget there, and they're still in my life. So again, curiosity compelled me to meet amazing people, to learn amazing skills, and has put me in touch with people like Rebecca, where I stand today. So I love what I get to do. The first time I actually wrote a real blog on my own was only, I think it was like 15 months ago. I'm 51. At 50, I wrote, like right before I turned 50, so I can technically say 49. I wrote my first blog. And I was, badgered to do so by a peer of mine. I was at LinkedIn. I was standing in a room of leaders, about 200 people. I'm standing in the back of the room and just chilling out. Steve walks up to me and goes, Pat, why aren't you up there mingling? You're an HR leader. You should be talking to people. You should be interacting with the employees that traveled all around the world to see you. I'm like, no. I'm an introvert. If it's unstructured, I lose my energy. So when I need to be there for them, when I need to play a role and help them, I get my energy and joy with that. But if it's unstructured social happy hour, freaks me out, won't go there, lunch, leave me 30 minutes by myself, love that. Have time, I'll read a book, I'll paint a painting and walk a dog, right? I don't go out with a lot of people. So he goes, you're an introvert? I go, yeah. So go away. And then she goes, no, you can't be. 60% of my team is introverted. Well, that's a lot. You don't talk much, do you, in the team meetings? And he was like, well, help me lead them. What's it like? How did you become an executive in Silicon Valley, head of HR, as an introvert? That's a story. Why don't you talk to my team? Better yet, why don't you blog for LinkedIn? I said, no, I don't write. Jeff Weiner's been bugging me to write. I'm not writing. No way, no how. I'll tell a story. I will not write. He goes, yes, you will. I'll give you 5 days. And I thought he meant I was going to write in 5 days. And I'm like, I'm not writing anything, Steve. Every day for 5 days, he texted me 5 times. Wore me out. It was like my children. I want. I wore out. By Sunday afternoon, Steve texted me the 4th time. I knew a 5th time was coming down the pike. And I'm like, stop. I'm sitting down. I'm writing it now. Don't bug me. I wrote the first blog. I'm an introverted executive in Silicon Valley. How the heck did that happen? That first blog gave me more gifts than I can ever tell you. I had probably 20,000 views. I had hundreds of likes and comments. And from there, I had conversations, interviews with Huffington Post, with Forbes, with HBR, with different people around the world going, how do you do it? How do you lead like that? Share us your tips and tricks. I want to be authentic. I want to find my voice. How did you find it? And I said, well, you start with not finding it, choosing it. Because in my head, I have many voices and many ideas. That's why I'm quiet. I am processing like a million different things. Finding something feels defensive, right? Doesn't it feel like I lost something when you have to find it? Like, where are my socks and shoes? It feels like I'm running out of time. Mom, where's my shoes? I don't know. When you have to find your voice, I feel insecure. When you choose which voice you want to be heard, that's power. And so I choose when I speak, on the topics in which I speak, and I save my energy and out it goes. And I find my joy by doing that. And so you guys have this privilege of writing and learning the magic of story, both in the written and verbal word. That's amazing to me. I just now discovered it. So there's like a whole nother life for me. I wish I was in your chair. I was going through this program, it would be amazing.
It would.
It would be. I'd be a good student, I swear. So I just want to start with who I am. So you can see my profile. It's not all of me, it's a piece of me. A mother of 3, a baby out of 8, good Irish Catholic family. My siblings are all over the world. Very close to my father. Mom passed away when I was 18. And I just love what I get to do every day because it's different and I'm curious. So what I'm more curious about now, you got to know me a little bit, what would you want to talk about? Any questions? And you can't be shy. I'll just be quiet. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming today. I'm very inspired by your story. Well, wondering, you talked about kind of finding your, not finding, but choosing your voice. I really want to know more of your thought processes of how you came to that conclusion and separated yourself from other people.
Great question. I was in my early 30s. I was learning how to be a manager, and I wanted to be a leader. Not a leader, but a great leader. And I wanted people to trust and like me and respect me. And I was told by a leader once that you can't be respected and loved. You have to choose one. In this world, it's respect. And I went home and thought about that. And again, it only took me one night, and came back and said, I disagree. I think I can have both. And I'm going to live my life with both. Because what is the world like with just respect? It feels shallow to me. I want people to smile when I walk in the room. But the conundrum for me as an introvert was that it was hard to read me if I was quiet, if I ate by myself, if I didn't socialize like everyone else did. It was hard to navigate and interpret my feelings. I was not the one to say hello in the morning on Monday and say, how was your weekend? That wasn't me. I was head down my checklist. So I got a coach. And a coach was saying, look, I got some 360 feedback on you, Pat, and there's some room for improvement. And I'm like, all right, I can do this. Bring it on, whatever that is. I didn't want to hear it. And the feedback was, she has to find her voice. She's so quiet. Find her voice. We don't know what she's thinking. Find the voice. And it made me mad. And I turned to this coach who happened to be a woman. I said, why are people always saying, find my voice? I have lots to say. And she's then turn it around and say, choose the voice you want to be heard and be deliberate about it. She goes, they don't know what you care about because you're not opening up a window. If you want people to follow you, they deserve a window. And I never thought of it like that. They need to know my style, first off. They also need to know what I'm thinking, what I care about. And so when I go into big meetings, and still to this day I do it, I highlight from the agenda, there's like five things we're going to talk about. I highlight the one topic that I emotionally care about and make sure either I voice my agreement to the topic we're talking about in alignment or my disagreement with the topic to influence a change. And if I do that in a meeting, I feel good. I also know, and this is a rule of thumb I developed early, if I think of something in a conversation more than five times, this is the bar I started with. If I think it five times, I must verbalize it in the moment. So I'll do a slash mark each time I thought of it. And this is not silly stuff like, I really like your hat. I would think it and tell you later. But like things I care about in the moment, like if I thought I'd, and I hit the fifth slash, like shoot, my hand goes up and I interrupt the meeting and I have a conversation. I reduce that to two. If I think the thought twice, it deserves to be spoken. So I taught myself to choose the voice in the moment. Did that help?
Hi.
Hi.
As a female executive, how do you combat gender imbalance within the workforce? And are there any challenges that you face as a female executive? And do you have any tips for a potential woman in the workforce?
Potential woman?
I mean,
she is not
a woman who potentially might have a job in the future.
Got it.
What do you mean potentially might have a job?
Yeah. Who does have a job? Who wants to grow?
Right now.
But you will. You will. You're entering the workforce, right? So you matter. So I'm actually going to speak about this in a couple of weeks in San Francisco. There are moments when I knew I belonged. I mean, we just talked about this at lunch. In a male-dominated world, which I lived most of my career, I didn't feel like I belonged. Do you know what I mean by that? So I would be in meetings, and most of the guys would get up and have their lunch and never think twice about inviting me. They would go out and have their beers or go do whatever they do, go golfing, whatever. And if it's a male-dominated thing and their pal thing, off they'd go and not look twice at me. But at some point, it's in some team, what occurs is a magical moment for me where I've debated with them, tussled with them intellectually, did something that got their attention, we broke down some barriers, we had some more casual conversations. They get up and go, Pat, you know, we're grabbing lunch, you wanna go? And they don't do it thinking that I'm a female, they do it because they want my company. That's a moment of belonging. And I've had these different moments of belonging in my career, and these are magical moments because I have the best loyalty when that occurs. I am so engaged when that occurs, and I love the team that does that for me. And the dynamics shift forevermore. They may not recognize the moment, but I do. As a woman, I was younger. You get into some sticky situations depending on the environment you're in. My advice to young women is know your boundaries. People can and will take advantage of you if you let them. Know how to say no, know your boundaries, know what your values are, and be clear about those things. Know your worth. Like I said, equal pay. Same job, equal pay. You have the right to ask and figure out what is the right pay and demand it, right? Get an advocate in the workspace. Get sponsors and mentors in the workspace, male and female. Women raise their hands for promotions. There's a ton of data for this. When you're 110% ready. Men raise their hands for promotions when they're 70% ready, knowing they can learn the difference. And they're right, they can learn the difference. But we want to be overly confident, convinced that we're going to be great, that we shut ourselves off from great opportunity. So that's where I get over my fear factor, my curiosity that next job compels me to raise my hand before I think I'm ready. And because my work ethic is so high, I'll work extremely hard to make sure I don't let them down. Women work really hard. So do men. But have more confidence in your learning ability and your agility, and don't let that slow you down. So that would be my guidance to you. All right? You're welcome. And find peers that you can navigate with. Any minority, anybody that you want to build a community with, how do you find, you know, how to navigate, you know, what feels right, if you need a bouncing partner, you know, have someone there with you at the workspace to share. That also makes it an easier way to navigate.
Pat, would you talk a little bit about chums?
Oh, yes.
One of the pieces of data that show that are most predictive of employee engagement and satisfaction in a business, according to the Gallup survey, is do you have a best friend at work? And that leads to something that Pat was telling us about at lunch today that I think is really fascinating. And I think it speaks to the point that she was making with you, because I want you to listen to what she says, and I want you to think about it in terms of grad school as well as in the workplace.
All right. So I think, and I'm very biased, that HR is sexy. What I get to do is a sexy job, just so you know. In case you're confused, I communicate a lot, so you could find your way into HR, and it's cool with me, just letting you know. But there's a lot of people in the world that don't see my function as hip as I do. I don't know why. So this summer, I asked my interns to host a non-technical hackathon in Silicon Valley. And we invited 1,200 interns around the Bay Area to join me one night from 6 p.m. at night, hack through the night to the next day, and we got judged on by noon the next afternoon, and we picked the winners. And so of that 1,200, 965 students, interns, said they wanted to sign up. We had more interest than we ever, I mean, we were hoping for 100 people. I'm like, oh my God, what do I do? It was a great problem to have. And these interns, we selected them. It was a great balance. It was 50-50 men, women. Only out of, we had 160 that showed that night. Only about three of them were HR backgrounds. You asked the students that came in, what did you know about talent HR? Negative numbers count? They knew nothing. Nothing about my profession, which is awesome. The topic was engagement. If you look at the number one topic blogged about, talked about on LinkedIn and on the business section of Huffington Post and Harvard Business Review, the Gallup studies, it's about employee engagement and the millennials. You can go on and on and on, the age, you know, the minorities, all this stuff. It's all about engagement. And so we said, help us with engagement. And so they broke into teams, they hacked a great idea, they proposed it, 36 teams, we brought it down to 10. And Chums was in the top 10. I love Chums. It was one of my favorites. They did their homework. They researched and they said, all right, there's this guy, call him Tom, he's an engineer. You just spent X thousands of dollars to hire this engineer. You onboard Tom in your technical company. You take him through tech boot camp, which cost you X thousands of dollars. So now you spend time, money, and effort getting this gentleman into your company. And within 6-7 months, he's gone. Why? Because he had no friends. He was an introvert. They played on my heartstrings. I'm like, oh, poor Tom, he has no friends. And then go, what did Tom need? He needed chums. And I go, that's what I need chums. Never knew. And they're like, he needs chums. And so chums, their idea is a pre-onboarding tool for new hires. So when you get offered a job at LinkedIn or any other company, you will get this amazing welcome package that's electronic now, no longer in paper. And you open up this wonderful website and it says, you know, what do you want as benefits? It gives you a little information about the job and the company, but then what are your interests? And these are big balloons that they had about hiking and jazz and painting and volleyball and softball. And if you click on it a lot, the balloon gets bigger to show your passion. You can pop it with a dart and it goes away. So you can indicate for me your level of engagement and interest in these topics, which is really cool. Now what happens when you onboard and you have your first orientation day, we sit you with people of like interests. Your chums are already around you. And we introduce you not by your name, but by your interests. So already your community is starting to build. Then when you log into the intranet site behind the firewall for the first time in your new job, there's a welcome package for you, inviting the volleyball team because you showed a lot of passion in volleyball. And oh, by the way, we have a jazz ensemble that plays every other week and blah, 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 aligned to your passion. And let me give you the emails of the people that participate in these clubs and these events. They're going to reach out to you the next 72 hours. You have friends before the week is out. That's chums. So community, feeling like you belong, and especially for gender, is a big deal. And for women, the feeling of belonging changes with your age and your life cycle. As a young female, as a young adult, you have different needs on socialization and community. When you're a young family, a new mom, you have different needs again of community because you care about other like moms. Who's in a spot like me? How do you juggle family and work? How do you do blank? So what your needs are changes. You need to find your chums depending on your life cycle and those stages. And so chums is an idea to get to that. So that was pretty cool. I like chums. Everyone can use a friend. Yes.
Hi. It's great to meet you. We're very thankful that you're here to speak with us. I just have a question because we know that you've been working with HR for so many decades. Is there a common trait that stands out in a potential employee or a interviewee that makes them more attractive as a hire for the long term? We know you talked about curiosity and being very flexible in learning as well as agility, but is there a particular trait, mostly when you hire, you see, oh, that's the person I want, or is there really not a one-size-fits-all kind of deal?
Well, I hire all different types of people. I like diversity at my table to make sure I have diversity of thought and approach. So when I build high-performing teams, I'm looking for the analytic, the extrovert, the introvert, the person that has very good intuitive skills, someone's very operational and programmatic and gets stuff done. I'm all big thinkers, dreamers. I want all that around my table. So when I'm building a team, a management team, I kind of look for those avenues. But the underlying platform of the type of person I look for, besides this agility and humility, is the next one. So I want you to be a learner. The world doesn't stand still. And a learner can handle ambiguity, times of change, better than most. So a learner, an agile thinker is great. But someone who's humble will also make sure they're listening more avidly to the people around them. If your ego is too big, you will have one tool that you play over and over and over again because you thought it worked at your prior company, you can apply it and apply it and apply it. It's a big hammer for the same nail. It doesn't work, right? So humility lets me know that when you use the we, you know how you fit in the ecosystem, so occasionally use the I. This is how I worked within that team. This is my contribution. But I couldn't have done what I did without so-and-so. Like, how do they give away the grace of gratitude and support for how you make accomplishments? I would say 99% of my accomplishments came through working with others. And so hearing that, understanding that, seeing how it resonates during an interview is a big deal. But you have to have confidence. Humility doesn't mean that you're insecure. It's just awareness of self and how you navigate and how you influence others and work with others and that you're open to others' ideas. That work?
Yes, thank you.
All right. Other questions?
Hi.
Hi.
So I had a question about the fact that you switched sort of between the industries so many times just because you were curious about it. So my curiosity also spans, I guess, multiple subjects or disciplines, right? So how did you, I know the first time you had to, you like made the sell to switch to go into sales, but how did you continue to do that throughout your career to convince somebody that even if you didn't have any prior background in a field that you would be able to succeed in it? Because I find often it's easy to, like for me, I like to make connections between subjects and I think they do tie over into different skills, but it's hard to communicate that in something like a resume.
It's so hard in a resume.
So if you have any advice or how you went about it, that'd be great.
I can only speak from my experience. So my uncle Roland, the one who told me about backpacking, my dad and my uncle both were in HR, so they were great first mentors. And Uncle Roland said, after 3 years in a discipline, you will be seen as that discipline. I didn't understand him well the first time. I grasped it. Grok that thought really quickly because it harmed me. And here's what happened. I was at Viacom and I went in for a comp analyst job at Viacom. Great gig. You're working for Viacom, MTV, Nickelodeon, you're in your 20s. It's just a party in Manhattan. Like, it's a great gig. Let me tell you, I had a great time. And I was loath to leave this company. So at my 3-year mark, my Uncle Roland calls me, hey, Patty, how's it going? And I said, amazing. Way too tired. Like, let me tell you what's happening in my life. And he goes, well, how long have you been there? And I said, oh, I've been there since, I don't know, like 3 years now. And I got promoted last year. And like, oh my God, I saw Paul Simon. I went through all the nonsensical things that, you know, I'm sure my uncle didn't appreciate. And he goes, oh, that's too bad. And I went, what? Like, I'm all excited and bubbly. What do you mean, Uncle Roland? This is awesome. He goes, that's not good. And I went, what do you mean not good? And he goes, I told you the 3-year mark. And I go, huh? He goes, I told you, once you're in a discipline for 3 years, what did I say? And I go, that's all they're gonna see me as, but I'm not a comp spreadsheet. Come on, that's stupid. I knew more than my uncle did. And he goes, honey, you're done, you're cooked. That's all that you're gonna see you as an analyst. I said, I'm the least analytical in the whole company. Uncle Roland, they can't see me like this. He goes, they do. And he goes, but it's time for you to leave that discipline. You need to go to the next country, you know, figure out your next skill set. And I said, all right, I'm not going to leave Viacom. And he goes, all right. And he goes, I bet you that's not going to work. And he, and I'm like, I bet you they do. And he goes, all right, I'll bet you dinner. And I'm like, fine. I hung up. I interviewed for 3 months. Now, this is a company that I worked for. They wouldn't hire me to do anything but comp. I know, it was sad. I had to leave a sexy job. Like, this is so awesome. And he was right. And Uncle Roland, you're right. They see me as an analyst. He goes, yeah, I told you, waited too long. And so I had to leave the job, leave the company to get a new job. And so it taught me two things. So when I was leaving Viacom, I'd already changed industries once, and I talked to Uncle Roland about that as well. And he goes, here's two things. If you stay in, because I love the sexiness of Viacom, if you stay in that industry, you'll only be known as that industry. So imagine Hollywood. If you're in that space, they are self-centered enough to think that you don't have skills to do anything else. Like, pharma is different than semiconductor versus internet versus financial services. They're all self-centered. They all say the same thing. I've been around. And he said, if you don't move industries, they will think your skill set only applies to entertainment. So now you got to leave industries and you got to find a new gig. But I didn't have any of the skills. So I'm trying to teach a different company, different industry that I'm a recruiter. I've never recruited in my life. And what I told them is about my agility to learn and my curiosity and why it matters and why I'm going to kick its ass. Because one day I'm going to run HR and I want to know how to identify talent, court talent, bring them in the door and make this company great. And so I'll be the best recruiter you ever saw. Give me your best recruiter. I'm going to buddy up to that person and kick their ass later, whatever it takes. And, you know, they would take risks on me. Same thing happened in Applied Materials. I was at Applied for 9 years and I probably had 5 jobs. And I convinced them to have me leave HR to do operations because I went to a different division who didn't really know me as HR to take a risk to put me in an ops role. Because I had a great reputation. And I convinced them that I'd kick ass. I just like, I'll learn it. I'll do it. I was that, you know, male 70% got it, I think. And I'll fake my way through it. I did it.
I feel like you have to be kind of a self-learner in that regard. Like, did you do readings or try to teach yourself or, like, I guess acquire any information on the different jobs before jumping over?
I'd like to say yes.
Why not?
I would like to say, no, I didn't. You know, I'm like, hold my nose and jumping in the deep end. That looks sexy and cool. I want to learn how to do legal integration from Israel. All right, let's do it. You know, I follow my curiosity. I didn't plan a lot of these moves, like flipping a quarter. You know, my dad thought I lost my mind, you know? He really did.
So did your husband.
Yeah, he was like, but he took me up on it. I thought he was graceful for that. So that was really cool of him. Love my husband. Huh?
And he won.
Well, we both won. He quit his job. That pissed me off, though. He quit his job in like 18 months. Like, I don't know how this quarter thing worked for us. It did. It worked beautifully. I have no regrets. Other questions? Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
So I'm actually hoping to get into a career in HR.
I'll hug you afterwards.
Okay. People talk about how HR is so sexy.
It is sexy.
My question was more about how, okay, firstly, when you choose to do HR for a company, how can you tell that that company will value or does value HR? Because I find that, I've interned for about four times during this program at Annenberg, and I've definitely gone from like a company now that really values HR and we get, you know, resources we need, and then before that it was a company where HR was just get us the people, you know, like that's all we need you to do and make sure we don't get sued. And
that's not sexy.
There's a lot of variety between people who are like, who are very passionate about HR and what it can do, and then there's the whole other side of HR, which is just more, you know, make sure that, yeah, we don't get sued. And how do you choose, or how do you help with an environment where HR is valued?
I think, good question. So I think in any discipline, you learn from good managers and bad, right? So from my function, I learned as much about what not to do in HR when you're not valued or not well-run versus those that are well-run and gives you more ideas, right? When I went to Yahoo, so prior to Yahoo, I was the head of HR for Line Technology. It was a medical device company, the Invisalign, the clear braces. You guys know that one? So head of HR for them, there was a cool gig. And Yahoo kept courting me, but it was for the number two HR role, not the number one. So my ego was like, I'm running my own shop. Not sure I want to go down a layer. But Yahoo was interesting at the time. But I wasn't quite sure I wanted to be at Yahoo, so I kept saying no. And they were courting me for about 6 months. And then they said, well, meet with Jerry Yang and Dave Tufilo, the founders. Why not? Of course, that'd be cool. Meet with Decker, you know, the CFO, why not? And then the person they wanted me to support was this guy named Zod. And Zod came from Oracle, and Oracle's notorious for hating HR. They hate us. They want us to recruit and do an Excel spreadsheet and get out of their way. You know, figure out the gray zones so they can operate legally or illegally. I'm not going to say, but they don't like HR. And so Zod came from that school that HR is a necessary evil, and he's a great spreadsheet jockey, so he doesn't need me for compensation. He's already got recruiters, why does he need me? And we got to talking, and Jerry and David really wanted Zod to have an HR partner because he had 40% of the workforce in engineering at Yahoo at the time, and they're going through huge growth, and his leadership was really needed to evolve to make sure they could scale, and they knew something was missing. That something missing is called EQ, emotional quotient, high IQ. He missed the sensitivities about the workforce. And so I interviewed with him, and I started to laugh, like halfway through the interview, and he goes, why are you laughing? And he's really tight, buttoned up. And I go, you're awesome. And he goes, what do you mean? I said, you're the most brilliant, ignorant man I've ever met. I'm like, you are awesome. And he goes, what do you mean by that? And I go, you have no idea what I can do for you. Like, you don't understand the magic that I could provide. Like, you have no sense of HR and like how we help cultures and how you make, I make you great. Like, I can make you amazing. And like, you have no idea. And I'm like, that's awesome. And he goes, why are you so happy? I said, because you don't know. Like, I can do just a little bit of magic and you think I'm awesome. I'm like, you're an easy, like, swish. And he got insulted a little bit. I don't know why. And then, and he's a gambler. I knew that too. He loved to play poker. And so I said, look, let's make a bet. And he was like, his eyes lit up. And he goes, what's the bet? I said, I bet you in 90 days, Zod, if I decided to work for you, of course, it was all my decision. I had no job offer. If I decide to work for you, 90 days, you will stop mid-decision making. Seek my opinion out. It won't be about comp. It won't be about employment. It won't be about employment law. It won't be about any of that normal stuff. And my opinion will change the trajectory of your outcome. It's like, no, it won't. I go, is it a bet or not? Mm-hmm. 90 days, within 90 days, I will change your outcome, the decision, a business outcome, nothing to do with HR. He was done. I said, well, make me an offer first. And so I got an offer. I met the bet in 80 days. And today we're lifelong friends. So HR doesn't have to be respected to be amazing. Comms doesn't have to be respected to be amazing. You do magic and people will rise above because of the support you give them. And shit happens, right? And then they come to you and they pull you and they want your opinions and things start rolling from there. That's what I love. If they already knew my magic, it wouldn't be as much fun, right? Bringing them along is kind of cool.
In a way, you have the advantage of surprising them.
Yeah. And so when you come into a company that doesn't really get what you do, and you get to be creative and think outside the box and change the perspective of what to demand, you've made them a better leader and a partner for you. And just changing the seeds along the way is what I love to do. You're welcome. What else? Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
So we've talked a lot about personal branding in our classes, and it seems like with every role that you've gotten, you've had your own personal brand and just been really gutsy and seeking agility and using your curiosity there. I'm just wondering how you kind of developed that along your journey, and then also how you use your introverted advantages in that role.
That's a great question. So I think my brand evolved, and part of it is through big mistakes I've made. I've made some really stupid mistakes, like big, visible, stupid mistakes. And I was taught to pick myself up. And I was taught that's how you pick yourself up, how quickly you pick yourself up, and the attitude in which you pick yourself up determines your future, not the mistake. And I didn't quite believe that until I made this big mistake and I let my ego get in the way. And I fell gloriously. So at Applied Materials, I had convinced the company to take me out of HR to be a business readiness leader to roll Oracle out globally. And so Applied Materials is like 80% technologists and data geeks, right? Very arrogant kind of breed. And HR is like low. And I'm a business readiness leader and there's a technologist leader and we report into a president. And my job is business readiness for the company for 2 years. And I just had a baby, right? So my third kid, I'm done, by the way, with three, just in case you're counting. Third kid, husband's staying home, thank God. I joined this journey for 2 years, travel around the world. And my job is to make the company ready for this Oracle implementation. We were changing the way we did forecast for revenue. We were changing our engineering machine and how we design and how we install systems around the globe. So if we screw that up, we screw up the company's revenue, full stop. Yeah, it's kind of scary, right? I didn't internalize how big of a change this was. Intellectually got it, process-wise, programmatically-wise, I got it. I was cockier than the day was born. I had Accenture next to me, IBM next to me, I had sponsors, I had a training arm, a comms arm, I had like a whole bunch of stuff around me, and we were locked and loaded. I had five divisions. I created a scorecard of readiness against five elements, red, yellow, green. And I went into my first leadership forum with the CEO of the company, the COO, and all these presidents. Talk about an audience. and all my data was accurate. Why? Because I spent nights auditing, where are they in their training? Where are they in the process, disaster recovery? I mean, I was like to the gnat's detail, I was right. And I show up, and out of the five divisions, three of them were red. One was yellow, one was green. And three of the presidents that had red, what do you think they do when they saw those red lines? Anyone can guess.
Said it wasn't true.
Yeah, what else would they say? How do you think their emotions were at that moment? Yeah, a few curse words. They were yelling, they were angry. What the hell, the F? I mean, it was like, wow, at me. And there was like five of us in the team, right? Because I thought we were kicking it. I had the great dashboard. Poor little girl next to me started crying. I go, shh, it's not good to cry. You're gonna have to leave. So I'd move up, she'd leave the room. Another of my teammates got emotional, like, yeah, I gotta go. And I turn around, and like, it was me left standing, and I was getting decimated by these presidents of the company, right? And the CEO leans back and he said, so, Miss Wadors, is this the outcome you wanted? And I didn't know what to say, right? I didn't want to be yelled at, but I know I was right. Mm-hmm. And then I realized that I was wrong. And so I'm like, something's wrong. I'm not quite sure what. And he goes, let's kill the meeting. This is not productive. This is not good for anyone, and I think you need to rethink what you're doing. And my whole career could have been crushed. I left that room. I knew I was dead. I mean, glorious blaze. Glorious. My boss, my boss's boss, walked in front of me. They wouldn't even talk to me. They were like, I'm like, stop, Steve! They wouldn't talk. So there I am, like totally screwed up. And I got into Steve's office. I go, you know, I screwed up. He goes, do you know what you screwed up? And I go, well, you know, they're mad at me. They didn't like the red. And he goes, you don't get it. Mm-hmm. And he goes, don't talk to me until you get it. And I go, but I screwed up. Again, don't talk to me until you get it. So he goes, I got to go. And so the next morning, again, a one-nighter. I didn't sleep that night. I go in the office, and I said, I think I got it. And he goes, what is it? And I said, I cared more about me being right than helping the company win, be successful. My objective was wrong. My arrogance of being right, my process, my design, my team kicking ass. It was all about me and my team and the data, and I was wrong. My whole job was to make these five presidents successful and the company profitable. They all should have been green. I should have kicked ass to make them successful. I shouldn't have been glorified in my data. And I told him that, and he goes, you're right. I said, but I screwed up. Like, this Jim Morgan doesn't want to see me again. These presidents won't trust me. I told, like, I should be fired today. And he goes, they're going to watch how you pick yourself up. And I go, how do I pick myself up? Think about it. Come back tomorrow. So I thought about it, and I made meetings, and I called another meeting 3 weeks later, and I kicked ass for 3 weeks. I don't think I went home for a couple of nights. And all we did was fix everything that was broken and why those groups were red. Their process, their training. I told them how do you get healthy, why they weren't doing X, Y, and Z. I made sure everybody in their teams understood why it was important. So when we went to that meeting in 3 weeks, there were yellow or greens, and a very healthy projection to be all green. And that's how I recovered. So confidence came through that mistake. And I made glorious mistakes. Probably every 2 years. I won't say it's every day, but glorious burnouts. When you try really hard, you're going to make some great burnouts. And I pick myself up and go, you know, I just sucked. I just really blew that. How do I fix it? Most people don't acknowledge the mistake. And that gives me courage to go forward. And as an introvert, it's through learning. I had a 360 as a manager. And when I was doing that legal integration of a division, out of 30 people I relied on globally, 10 of them hated me. I could tell. Their emails were like long. They wouldn't return calls. I was traveling around the world. And the longer they didn't respond to me, the longer I had to be on the road. And as a new mom, I wanted to be home. And so them not liking me impacted my success. And so I got a 360, but really it wasn't. I just said, interview these 10. Why do they hate me? And it was because they didn't know who I was. They didn't know I was an introvert. They go, why didn't she go out socializing with us? She never joins us for lunch. I don't know what her values are. I don't know why she's doing this job, blah, blah, blah. And it was all because I was an introvert. And so I went to each of those people two a day for 5 days, thanked them for their feedback, and explained who I was and how I apologized to them, that I should have showed my appreciation. I should have extended myself to them, and I didn't. And I was wrong. If I want them to follow me, I have to find that window so they can see me. And out of the 10, 6 ended up working for me again at Yahoo and other companies. So it's how you pick yourself up.
So I have a quick question just about, you know, obviously going into the job force and, you know, being recently grad, you have this sort of openness to new opportunities and, you know, you want to say yes to everything. I'm actually having the opposite problem almost 5 years out and almost wanting to be a little bit more comfortable saying no. And in like, what tips do you have as far as, you know, being able to be more selective and authentic and focused with new opportunities and be able to say no to things without having that regret or like, should I have done that, you know?
Every path you take, you shouldn't regret, full stop. Whether it ends up the way you expected it or not, it is a great experience. I mean, from bad managers to industries I didn't really like, something has taught me something to lean from, right? So never have regrets, that would be first. When you are becoming more discerning in your career choices, do you have a career model that you're looking at? Like, every year I do a plan for myself. It's not a 1 year plan, it's a 3 to 5 year plan. And I write on there, what are my values, to remind myself what motivates me and my values. And the priority ranking of these things differ depending on where I'm at in my personal life and professional life, right? So money is a big object when you're growing a family or your kids go to college. Making a good income matters, right? If you don't have that expense, then I can take more risk financially. When my kids were younger, my husband quit his job to raise the kids, I could travel. Before that, I couldn't, right? I didn't want to put the burden on the relationship. So I always am clear, every year I revisit what's motivating my values so I don't stray. It's very easy to get distracted. Then I go into things, what am I mastering already? Where do I feel kind of cocky about that I'm good at and I could rock any day? And I want to list those and feel really good about them. And then what skills are emerging? Things you're learning, right? And then I rank them against joy. You know, I'm learning because I have to, or I'm learning in it because I'm really curious about it, is how I look at those two things. Like, I learned spreadsheets and pivot tables out of necessity, not out of joy, right? But I learned how to do teaching and training out of joy. I didn't realize I had that in me. So certain things are emerging, I'd pop up above the line, and certain things were below but were necessary to build. And then there's a third bucket of curiosity, of things I want to explore and experience in my life. And that curiosity bucket is what drives me to accept different jobs at different points in my life. Like, there was a moment in time that I wanted international travel, just want to do it. And I gave myself 3 years to travel. So the next gig that came along, I said, you know what, we'd like 30% of your time traveling internationally. Done, you know, versus everything US-based, right, if I had the choice. So that spreadsheet, every year I do it and revisit it. So if you don't have that, you will accept things that may not keep you on your compass as much as you like it to be. Does that help?
Yes, I love that.
Pat, would you talk more about that in the context of entry level or junior, or one half a step up from entry level, which is where a lot of them are, as they're starting to send out resumes and make sure they have a really great LinkedIn profile.
Of course that.
And if we could figure out a way to grade it, we would. But a lot of them are coming to me and saying, you know, I'm applying to all these jobs and nothing's happening. And I talk to a bunch of different people about what should my cover letter look like and what should my resume look like. I talked to 20 people, I got 35 different
answers.
Opposing answers.
Yeah.
You know, what do I do? And since you told me that half of your staff are recruiters, by the way, a good way to get into HR.
The easiest way, yeah.
What can you share with them?
So I'll go back to traveling throughout Europe. So I coached a gentleman recently. He graduated in December, and his only work experience was through like a snack shack down the street from his parents' house and working on motorcycles. And he got a finance degree. And I asked him, why did you ever think of doing an internship? No, I didn't think about that. And I said, but what are you applying for? Finance, investment banking. I'm like, wow. You showed passion in those spaces by what? And so he realized his behavior didn't align up with the degree, right? Learning how to solve problems, how to build your network is what the university should be providing you right now. Your first job is only that. Your first job. It's not your life. It's a step. You will get skills whether you want them or not. You will know what's good or bad whether you want to learn them or not. You'll learn what a great manager is whether you want to or not, because you'll have a manager. You'll know how you'll want to be led for the first time. Having a teacher and a counselor is way different than having a manager, right? They're different than a parent. And so every experience you have adds value to you. So remember that first and foremost. And play like Goldilocks. Each chair provides you different experiences, big, small, or perfect, right? It's very hard sometimes to find that perfect chair because you don't have enough information in your personal database to know what is great for you. You really don't. When I talk to students and they say they have a very narrow thing that they're looking for, I want to be a MarCom specialist in the media space that only deals with X. I'm like,
now
wow.
You're embarrassed about 17 of them.
Well, that is so hard, right? Rather than, I want to learn how to communicate like crazy. I want to use my words to change behaviors and change the world. Now the world just opened up, right? Flirt with MarCom if you can. Go into HR, go into finance, go into IT, go into engineering. You can go in so many paths to touch the elephant. It's not the one sliver. If you go after that one sliver, you've reduced your odds of getting a job in that space, like, oh my God. Your job is to get life and work experience. That is your goal. Second goal is to get close to your field as possible so you have an awareness of it. And you try it on. And what you want to do is try on a job for no longer than what? Someone's paying attention. 3 years. If you have not shown adaptability from that job, a stretch of greater than 25% or 40% in that job in those 3 years period of time, you will be pigeonholed. So what you want to do is touch the elephant of life and work experiences. If you're there less than a year, I think you're just flirting with it and you're not a great worker. You haven't left a legacy. When you work for a year, you kind of see it, kind of flirt. Year two is when you fix your mistakes. And year three is mastery. That's why you got to get out before you master something, right? Because that's all they will see you as. You will know you mastered it before the people around you actually will, because you will start to get bored. And people's change curve varies, but there's a natural cadence that the world has found, especially in Silicon Valley. Do you know what that is? It's 3 to 4 years. That's why they put stock plans with a 4-year vesting on average. They know when they're starting up companies and entrepreneurs that you have a development life cycle of 3 to 4 years to develop a product, launch a product, see how it resonates in the market, and you want to keep your core team together. And people get bored between 3 and 4 years. If your job has not significantly changed in that period of time, you will naturally look up and find something else to do. Whether you love the people you work with, it doesn't matter. It's a natural curve. They are the rare breeds, and I've seen them and I love them. I call them pros in place. They geek out on what they do and can do it every day. And I love them. There's not that many of them. There's really not. And that's great, because that makes HR sexy. Because all you guys are different. That makes my job fun. Did that answer your question or help?
Yes.
Okay.
Hi. Thank you for coming today.
My pleasure.
So I believe you must know about Third Space from USC.
Yes.
So which means in LinkedIn, for example, there are engineers and MBA, like business people. There must be a third space where people with empathy, adaptability, intellectual curiosity, 360-degree thinking, all that.
Wow, you're
for
good.
More like buzzword, because I try to explain the third space theory when I have phone interview or something. But could you please tell us some example of third space in LinkedIn? I believe there are a lot in your job.
There's a ton.
And a slight question, because a few days ago, the stock market for LinkedIn dropped.
Ouch.
Over.
Oh. I forgot to tell them.
Ouch. I said, I'll talk about anything but the stock market. I'm kidding. I'm fine. I'm just kidding.
We know, like, Jeff made a speech
it's going
about
up again.
How to convince people that you're the same thing.
You're
before.
Up on your, yeah, good for you.
How do you think about that? Or inside of the company, how, you know, HR people to keep them around employees and how to build up the team.
So my mission in the company and wherever I work is to build a high performing, healthy company that scales. And so when I put that mission down, Jeff Weiner goes, Pat, I get high performing, scaling, but I don't get healthy. What do you mean by healthy? Is that wellness programs? I'm like, no, Jeff, that's not wellness programs. Healthy means, and wellness plays a part of it, don't get me wrong, but a healthy company is one that's inclusive. Everyone feels like they belong, that they're performing their best. It means that you have the tools necessary to do your job. They feel respected and rewarded. That you feel that you're compensated well for your work that you're delivering for LinkedIn. Healthy means that when you have needs, people will be there for you. You have your chums. That's all part of a healthy organization. The healthier I make LinkedIn, so when the stock drops, because every company your stock will drop, you don't want to leave that company. Because when the stock rises up again, you still have this great company to play in, right? So that's what we've been building. And so we are that same company we were 2 weeks ago, 3 months ago, as we are today. Now, there are people in their value set that money really matters and doesn't make them greedy, right? We have to dispel that money is a bad thing, that ego is a bad thing, and politics are a bad thing. They're all good. It's how you use them and how you look at it. And if people are in a lifestyle that they need to make X dollars and 90% of their income's on equity and we just crushed it and they need it this year because their kid's going to college, they may in fact look for another job because that's so important to their family, and that's okay. Right, but if you're building a high, healthy, performing company, very few of those will drop out. My cash is great, our bonus plans are great, they're paying out, our revenue is strong, we have a great future. We just mismatched on the expectations for the year. The analysts got away from us, and the macroeconomics also are on the ski wad. So everyone's like jittery in the marketplace, and we got nailed. And so if we took it personally, our motivation would be down. But if you understand context, it shouldn't get you down. Pisses you off a little bit when your balance sheet goes down, but it shouldn't kill you. Did I answer your question?
And about the third space.
Oh, the third space, yeah. You had a lot there. I was like, trying to track everything. It got me distracted with the stock price. So on third space, when you interview, you have to be cautious about the language they use so they can interpret what you mean, full stop. So when I talk to vets about working in the private space, what they say in the armed forces and how they lead and how they show their skills does not translate in our world. Same thing with volunteers. If you're in a volunteer community and you're helping Second Harvest Food Bank, if you're helping, you know, urban youth, what you do and how you do it doesn't translate into the private work sector, even though you have the same skills. So third space has all the right elements. It just painted a different word. And so what you want to do is show your agile learning, adaptability, self-awareness, right? You have a strong IQ and EQ. The world knows you need it. And what the school has provided you is a framework called third space, right? And so you can give them the framework around all those natural language points. But it's rare to have engineers have a high EQ and empathy. Those that do rise quickly to the top in terms of the leadership to rally the troops and become talent magnets. Right? And then other roles demand it. Like, you cannot get successful without those elements and know how to navigate that as well. All right? Questions? Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
I was wondering how your position in within LinkedIn is impacted by, say, where either you or other executives see LinkedIn going in the future, in terms of like its existence as a social and professional networking site, and how that future vision for the company impacts who you're looking to take into the company.
Very good question. So my role, and I just had this conversation with our board this past week. My role has evolved over the last 3 years I've been at LinkedIn. Year one was building my team and the platform play of HR. When you're building capability and earning trust, you have to build a stable system of data, integrity, compliance in order to be sexy on top, right? So some of that stuff has to get done. And getting the right team in place so you can look around corners and anticipate growth, you got to build that with you. So that was my year one. And I did a lot of change in some of the programs and systems and tools, but that internally focused was year one. Year two was fixing my mistakes. Remember I told you year one is kind of playing and flirting? Year two, I had some mistakes that I had to tweak and learn from. And I continued to move the needle on certain initiatives in the company and started to learn my customer base a bit better. And this past year, last 18 months, 15 months, probably 40% of my time is outward facing to the customer. So I'd say greater than 50% of our revenue is in talent solutions. It's a recruiter tool, it's the data analytics, it's the job profile, the company profile pages, how do you look at all that, how do you navigate and network, that's all in my space. And so what I've been doing is talking to my peers, my customers, and providing more of a coaching and advisory role. So I get to do what I love to do in my career, but on steroids. So I get to play in every industry sandbox. So I've talked to Charles Schwab, I've talked to Burberry in London, I got to see where the design center was. I mean, I get to look in some cool places, really cool stuff about talent brand. They have a problem with talent brand at Burberry, believe it or not. They have a design center that is like fancy as all get. I just wanted to pet the clothing. It was awesome. I was like, this is so cool. And the food there was great, the people were happy, but everyone else in the company worked across the street in a gray building with no windows. I am not lying. It was the most god-awful workspace I've ever seen in my career. And they took me, they go, look at our design center, it's so awesome. They're like, welcomed me there. And I'm like, oh, this is great. Then they said, our meeting is across the street. And I'm like, okay, so we go across the street. And the room is like that back wall with another wall identical to it with a big table in it and like two pictures. That was my whole day. I went nuts. I'm like, oh, and they go, we have a talent problem. Why do you think that is? I'm like, oh, shut this building down. So I get to do that all the time with my customers and my team. And so what I'm teaching my team to do, one of my key initiatives I just blogged about actually 2 days ago is called PCP, funny enough. So PCP is partnering with customer and product. So I swim out to my customers, get their pain points, what are they facing, how are they looking at our data, how are they leveraging LinkedIn or not, how are they leveraging my competitors or not, bring that information in. If I can teach them how to do something better, I will. I'll actually plug and play some of my team, my recruiters in AXA, for example. I've done it in Pharma, I've done it in L'Oreal. I've taken small teams of my resources and plugged them in and make them great. And then I take my team back, and they're not spies, but they give me insights about what's working, what's not, and I take that to the product team, I swim back downstream and say, you need to fix your product. One of the hottest things that we're trying to figure out is diversity on the profile. Two major diametrically opposed philosophies are going on in the marketplace about the profile. Do you know what they are? Can anyone guess? It's a quiz. No failing, though.
Culture fit versus diversity?
No, but close. So here's what happens. There's an assumption. Data shows if you're blind, you remove bias. So if you take away the photo off the profile, your name, and your school, where you went to school, chances are you remove bias and you increase the odds of underrepresented minorities and women getting hired. And so people are saying you've got to strip all that out of the profile. And I'm like, well, that's fascinating because we've been saying the opposite. In order to really do your resume, in order to share who you are, get your picture up there, really showcase, right? So that was like weird. And then the other side is actually looking at the data, which I find personally fascinating. What if I, as a hiring manager, recognize that I need to have a better diverse workforce? Not because the law tells me, because the data shows a diverse team wins every time. Every time. If you have a diverse board of directors, a diverse leadership team, you have better earnings per share in the market, and you dominate the market compared to your competitors who are less diverse. Jack Ma at Alibaba recognized this early on. He has the best balance management team out there, and he's dominating. So when you have diversity, you win. So if you believe in that, and diversity is not just by color, it could be by where you grew up. It could be you came from an international perspective. It could be you had different industries in your background. It could be multiple languages, diversity of a lot of different things. So what if you plugged in an algorithm into my sourcing tool as a hiring manager and say, I look like X, Y, and Z. I want to look like this. When I source my talent, give me a bar, an algorithmic bar that tells me how diverse is my slate of candidates that meet my criteria. Or am I hiring just like me again? And they can do red, yellow, green. If it's green, it means that I'm creating a diverse pool that chances are I'll increase the diversity of my hiring. Or if it looks just like me, it's red. You're just hiring just like you, Pat. Danger. Don't do that. That's interesting, because then you have to be consciously biased. People don't come to work to screw up. They don't come to work to discriminate or to hurt others. So conscious thought actually fights bias better than anything, than making it blind. I think blind is like a Band-Aid. But our tool, going back to the product, we're allowing it to do both now. We're allowing it, you can strip off the photos if you want. We're experimenting with some customers. And then we're looking at the algorithm about a diversity algorithm. It says, you know, as you're sourcing and you plug in what you have today, can it give you some indications based on your criteria that you want? So you have to be conscious in your thought. So the world is evolving, and the technology and how I respond as a talent leader is changing. So what I look for in talent at LinkedIn, a lot of our workforce is in the recruiting talent space. How to identify talent, what is the social economic conditions of the world around talent across India, China, you name it, because we want to be where they are. I care about that. From an engineering perspective, I compete with Uber and Google and Facebook, et cetera. High bar of software engineers, and the networking data discipline it takes to generate and maintain something like LinkedIn is huge. With over 400 million profiles in the tool, it's huge. You got 2 billion professionals in the world. We're trying after them. That's who we want, by the way. So if you don't have a profile, get one.
They better all have a profile.
Yeah. Questions? Is this helpful, by the way?
Yes.
It is?
We're going to take those two questions.
Okay.
And then we're going to give Pat a little bit of a break, and we'll keep going.
All right, that's fine. Yes.
Hello again.
Hello again. I like your nail polish, by the way.
Thank you. I'm trying to go for the minty green. Okay.
Yeah, I need some inspiration.
So I recognize that diversity is very important. I actually minored in that with my undergrad. Diversity is very important, but as someone who recruits, how do you say that you really want to recognize people's different unique assets and what they bring to the table? How do you kind of recognize that in people when you interview them? Do you kind of get a vibe from them, like, oh, this person is very organized, versus like, oh, this person, after meeting with him, he seems very book smart or
yes.
analytical.
Yes. So I love creative thinkers, but they are terrible in operational execution. Terrible. Right? They don't think about milestones and accountability and metrics and the ROI and the cost of doing the plan if the plan is off and how many resources it takes to get shit done. They don't think like that. So if I hire someone that's a creative thinker, and you need them, you need someone to paint a future that's compelling, I need an operator to balance their voice out. I need an optimist that sees the world as beautiful, and I need a pessimist that's a critical thinker that says what will break. Right? I need someone to balance out my debate. I need someone that adds humor, because we deal with life and employee issues, and it's personal. You can't tell me anything I do is not personal. We say it's business, I'm not saving lives just to make it like back off the emotions a little bit, but everything we do is personal. what I pay you, how I treat you, you're having a family, you're getting a divorce, whatever the case may be, you got a bad review, it's all me, right? So it's very hard for a human being to disaggregate who they are from what they do, right? And so I need a humor on my team. I need someone that really thinks and gets the research and thinks ahead of my game and says, Pat, have you thought about that? I need all that at my table. So when I interview, I sit back and I write my matrix with my dance partner. I usually have someone on my team that helps me write down what I've got on my team. Go, yep, Maggie's humor. Nina's a kick-ass programs leader, negotiator. I need one of those. We spend millions of dollars. I need someone who's a talent magnet, right, that can get the best of HR out in the valley because they want to follow him or her no matter what. I need someone that knows blank. And then I plug and play the names and see what boxes are missing, and then I recruit for that, for the balance of my team. Right, diversity of thought and style. So intentionally I go after diversity.
Pat, how often do you see that in as conscious a way as you look at it, in, you know, globally?
I think it's rare. I find it, it's going to sound so self-serving, and I don't mean it to be. You find in high-performing leaders in high-growth companies that have the knack to do that, so they balance each other out and they're not blind. If you get a lot of like thinkers, you make bigger mistakes. You don't know you're making a mistake until it's too late. You don't want yes people all the time. You want people to challenge you. So strong, confident leaders that have, you know, built for scale, that have handled challenging times, consciously think about the diversity around their table. Because you don't want to be the emperor with no clothes. And that's how I was coached. You don't want to be naked. And I sure don't want to be naked. That would not be good.
Shelby, and then we're going to take a 5-minute break, and we'll come back.
So thank you for coming. I know a lot of other people have said it too, but it really is exciting to have you be here. We're all anticipating it.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course. So I personally really identify with Dr. Weintraub's question about, you know, just putting out so many applications and trying to reach out and just not getting responses back. I mean, I personally have applied to over 200 jobs in the last 2.5 months and haven't had anything.
All right, let me help you. Here's what you do. You want practical, real practical tips? Don't
apply. Get out your pen.
This is real practical tips. This will. I almost want to bet you lunch, but I don't know how you're going to pay me back. So I'm going to win. You will get calls back within 3 to 6 months of multiple employers if you do what I say. If you want to work for an industry, find out who you know in that industry. If you don't know anyone in that company or that industry, find a way to get to meet them. Worst case scenario, you do a company tour, right? And you know, I'm at USC. I want to see your company. Do you mind if you can give me a courtesy tour of your facility? The person who's giving you the tour, you immediately connect with them on LinkedIn and thank them so very, very much. Then you find out who's else in their network and you connect with them. I heard from Lauren that you are a kick-ass recruiter, and she said, I could talk to you about tips on my profile. What do you think about my profile? I'm happy to take you to coffee. You meet with Sam. Sam teaches you about your profile, a little bit more about the company. You have an 86% chance of return call on your reach out if you have a warm introduction by someone in that company. So you need to create the warmness. When people reach out cold, then you're relying on a search of keywords that vary from company to company and industry to industry, and you're lost before you start. And so it's through the network. And I knew that before LinkedIn. This is not about a pitch for LinkedIn. It's through who you know. I didn't interview for a job, really reach out for a job until I left Yahoo. I would decide to leave Yahoo, but every job interview I got was from someone that knew me, that knew somebody that was looking. My network propelled me forward. And so if you're not sending a resume out to somebody or an application out to somebody that you know, chances are you're going to be ignored. My son, funny enough, he surprised me. He's a biochem major. I know nothing in the sciences, right? I worked on a dental med device company, not big deal, right? And he's looking for internships. I was not connected, I could not help him, but he heard that advice from me. And so on spring break, over a year ago, last year, he went and did a tour of Genentech. And he didn't know anyone. He just went in. He heard they were doing student tours. He went in for a tour. He met. He got connected with them on LinkedIn. He got a job. They emailed him 2 weeks later and said, "Have you applied for internships?" They followed up with him, and he worked there last summer. His GPA is not the best. Like, if you're talking about criteria to work in that kind of company, 40,000 applicants for 400 jobs for internships. What happened is that he connected at a human level and found three people that liked him on a tour, and they helped to advocate for him to get a job. It's who you know. And so, you know, do your funnel. You can reach out as many as you want, but the three or four that you really want, get warm connections, find the person. If you don't know, find the person that finds the person. Leverage LinkedIn, leverage Facebook. Don't tell LinkedIn I said that. Twitter, whatever you need to get connected to that source. And if you don't know them, reach out and say, "I don't know you." If you do an invite on LinkedIn, never just say the standard invite. Few of you that attended today, I don't know who you are, but I'll look on my LinkedIn profile. So, several people knew I was coming today and sent me invites. Those of you that personalized it, I accepted. I'm going to hear you talk in 2 weeks at Annenberg. I can't wait to hear you. Thank you for joining me. I accepted. I don't even know who you are. But the fact...
But though, LinkedIn, if you want to connect with somebody and customize it, you have to say, how do you know that person, and give that email address.
Choose no? friend.
Choose friend. There's a workaround. Choose friend.
And then it doesn't ask you for
right. Unless someone asks for a privacy blocker, then you have to know it. Yeah. But very few people put a privacy blocker on LinkedIn. So personalize your invite. Personalize, personalize, personalize. Especially people that are busy, that's the way to get their attention. And then follow up. Thank you for accepting my connection. I love company XYZ. I did, you know, show them that you've done some research. Demonstrate curiosity, awareness, and ask for support. As soon as you ask someone for support, you've enlisted them into your circle. And if you succeed, they succeed. If you fail, they fail. So the more you enlist people in those companies to help you find a job in their company, you bring them in your journey with you, and that's to your advantage.
Although when you have those information at interviews and you demonstrate your interest, they say you should not ask for, like, "I need a job, can you help me?"
It's after the interview.
Okay.
You ask for feedback, how'd I do, what critique do you have for me, thank you so much. You try to build a warm connection. But you gotta know when to play it. Right? If you're just doing informational interviews, stay in the role. It's an informational interview. If you feel like there's a warm connection there, you step out of that role, "Thank you so much. I really like your style. What could I have done better?" You know, like, bring them in. You know, make them part of your circle. As humans, we are a community. And as soon as I feel like you're my community, my tribe, as they say, I will make you more successful.
So there's one network you all have that I'm not sure you use very well. What is that?
USC.
Yeah. The USC Mafia is not to be looked at lightly. How
it's
many
not.
Of you have gone to an alumni event that is not on campus? Okay, yeah, that's not enough hands. How many of you do it regularly? Okay, that's even less.
Wow, look at you.
So you really
Cameraman's
need
got the gig.
To you. And by the way, it's not just the Annenberg Alumni Network, although that's pretty powerful. So I want to be respectful of Pat and her energy. So we're going to come back at 3:45 on that Mickey, and try not to inundate her, okay? Want to give her, remember, she's an introvert. Want to give her
this
a chance
is good,
to renew.
Though. This is good, because when I help others, I give my energy, but I'll crash on the plane. So
okay.
Well, don't follow me to the plane. That's when we break up.
All right, so we're going to take 7.
Thank you. I have to think about that.
Not overnight.
No, not I got only today, so I'll be quicker on my feet. All right, what other questions that you guys have? Yes?
You talked a lot about changing within, like, the company, the example of the guy that you kept going to see to get into sales. But if you've broken the 3-year rule and been somewhere for a really long time, how can you break out of that and convince a new company to take a chance on you?
Definitely use relationships to help you break through. If someone that used to work with in that current company they've been at for 5-10 years has gone somewhere else, take them to lunch, take them to coffee. You say, look, I really like your company. I want to change industries. I'm bored. It's ready for a change. How do I do it? What do you guide me to do? These are my core 5 skills I think are transferable. This is what would get me excited to get up every day, again, solving new problems. What does that look like in your company? And then they will help brainstorm with you and introduce you to the next person, the next one, like, who can you introduce me to in your company? So you start getting those warm connections to help you break out. I used to work for a company, Plantronics, 50-year-old some odd company now. They had a layoff about 2 weeks ago, unfortunately, and about 100 people were let go. And it's an amazing culture. I love this culture. Very hip and Santa Cruz loving culture. These people have been there. Some of them have been there for 20 years and got laid off. That's so hard, right? And so they reached out to me. I hadn't worked with them in 3 years. And they say, Pat, I was part of the layoff. Very blessed to have worked at this company for so long. It helped me afford my house and raise my family. But I'm on to my next thing. What advice would you give me? Can I buy you coffee? That was the smartest thing they did, right? And I will feel empathy for them. I will help them break doors. I think they're great human beings. I'll find a way. So figuring out how to do that. But when you're aggressively building your career, that 3-year mark is pretty clear for the skill sets. You don't get pigeonholed too quickly and or industry wise, unless that's the passion you have. Like when I was at Viacom, I could have worked in entertainment all my life. I thought it was so awesome, right?
One last question, I promise.
That's okay.
What is your...
As long as you have good questions, no one minds.
Well, here's to hoping.
Yes.
What is your opinion on graphically designed resumes? Because I've had mixed feedback from different people. Some people say it looks like you're trying to distract from your lack of experience. Some people are saying, oh, that actually is a nice break from seeing just black and white, super structured. What are your thoughts?
I'm glad you asked that question. Because I hate the graphic ones. And if I'm giving you all really bad
advice, is,
I want to know that.
If you are applying for a graphic designer job, go for it. It's your portfolio, you're showcasing your skills. If you're going for something else about communication, focus on the words and the layout. If it is more and more, LinkedIn is the digital resume. And there's other digital resumes that are coming out, different platforms that are coming out. But trying to showcase who you are through those vehicles is the right thing to do. If you have a resume that is very detailed in writing and paper, mm-hmm. that you can send to them on email, and then LinkedIn's profile is a skeleton of what you share, it's gonna not make you as attractive to a recruiter either. So they look for you on LinkedIn. Make LinkedIn your resume. Whatever you use as your digital footprint, make that your footprint. That CV that you have that's in writing is an additive thing that it's got to tell something different, right? But it's not, it shouldn't be how you're found and discovered.
Okay, so you shouldn't base it on the kind of company that you're applying to, but rather the role?
The role. Okay. Who's looking at you?
Yeah, and then what about, marketing in my mind kind of falls in the gray area for roles. Would you say that that is one of those gray area roles where it could go either way with the type of resume that you submit, or?
If I were interviewing for marketing, mm-hmm. I'd like to know the marketing campaign, so showing me links on your profile, the marketing campaigns that you have done to demonstrate some of the videos that you've taken, the advertising promotional items that you've done. You can link those into your digital footprint to showcase without having it be over-worded. The same thing you can do on your written document. You can link to websites to demonstrate what you've done so you can show your creativity.
Apart from all of these links and examples that you're talking about, how does what's the balance between what should be on your resume and on your LinkedIn profile? How should they be different or similar, and what are recruiters looking for in a resume and a LinkedIn profile?
They're looking for the same thing.
Okay.
The resume is relied upon because you have the creativity to index on different jobs depending on what you're applying for, versus the resume stays as it. The LinkedIn profile stays as is. So that you're in conflict. So I want to look like an ops person to one hiring manager. I want to look like a marketer to the next and a finance person to the why. That's hard to do. When they look up on LinkedIn, it is what it is, right? So you got to be authentic first and foremost. So make them the same. What I would say in your summary story is make it your story. constant curiosity, active learner, seeking experience in finance, marketing, anything that gets me up in the morning, excited to learn. You know, showcase
your... That would work if they were applying to you.
It would, but I'm saying showcase who you are, right? If you're finance, what they want to know is, what about finance? What sets you apart from the others? And demonstrate in the details of each job the size of prize, right? If you're in sales, what was your revenue, your quota, the complexity? If you're in finance, public accounting, private accounting, nonprofit, profit, et cetera, like you've got to give some markers so people know complexity, size, and growth. Those are things that recruiters look for. They want to show growth in your path. And they want to know that you've stayed long enough to be accountable for your work. So if you've been a year, you've never been accountable. I think there's something.
Pat, before you go off that, a lot of them are looking entry level. We talked a little bit about internships and other kinds of work experience and not bartending necessarily. But what, so if you don't have all that history and you know, you've got some internships, you've got grad school, how do they, what do they do to capture that recruiter's attention? And I'm going to assume they're applying for the right level of job.
Right. So internships, paid or unpaid, or equal. So if someone tried, I just had a conversation earlier. If a recruiter is trying to make you feel like an unpaid internship is less valuable, call BS on that. You're learning skills, you're adding value, and actually showing more discipline and motivation because you're giving up your time to learn this skill. Right? So play to your strength. Don't let people put you, it's like finding your voice. Like how, you know, nah, I got a lot of voices, I'm choosing which one I tell you. It's the same thing. You have to thematically be able to show your strengths and why you made your moves. So internships, if you're in finance 1 year, pharmaceutical the next, and then, you know, an attorney's office the next one, why did you choose those decisions? Is it because someone knew you and you just grabbed whatever you had, or was there really a thought around it? Share that. Why did you go to grad school? What did you do while in grad school? If you had to work your way through grad school, not having an internship in your field makes sense, right? If you gotta make money, you gotta make money. If you can work and do an internship in your space and acquire skills and learn, then showing your network has been broadened by that internship is an indicator of healthy relationships. So every internship and job you've had, make sure you have connections to those people. Because recruiters look for that. They look for affinity scores. Affinity. It's a secret. Don't tell anyone. It's like if people worked for me in the past and followed me, it's a leadership trait. Managers are looking for those clues. Will people follow you? Did they like working with you? Are you connected to them? Did they like working, you know, did you solve problems with people? Can I talk to Susie about you? I know Susie from someone else. Like, show the richness of your experience and who you leveraged and who you worked with, because it shows more confidence in who you are and more trust. They may never reach out to them, but you give them an impression of trust. If you worked, this is a real story. This gentleman applied for a job, an executive job, highly paid job. He claimed a job probably within 5 years of applying to this company that showed zero connections to that company, who supposedly was there 3 years. Zero connections in that company. I'm like, that is so weird. And I didn't pursue it. I didn't think about it. And then the guy was saying something else that was kind of funky to me, and my intuition flared. I'm like, wait a minute, this guy's a little off. He doesn't have any connections to that company. You know, he's not willing to give me a reference until I make an offer, and I like to do some background now because I'm feeling a little wonky. The guy never worked there. He got fired. He worked there, I think, for like 5 days, falsified his documents, and got fired. You think it's funny? I'm like, holy shit. And so he claimed he worked there, and he stayed home, supposedly raised, you know, his family for a couple years, tried to find a job, couldn't, then found a job. But he acted like he had no break in service. And he didn't want anyone to know about it, and so he just exaggerated. And I said, too bad you don't get a job. But your network is your shadow. And so how you build your network is valuable.
Now, what do you do if you're in a situation where, for example, like with internships, a lot of the ones that I worked in, there's a lot of turnover at those jobs and in those departments. So someone who
for
I worked
internships.
For, yeah. So people that I worked for at that point in time or that were my supervisors are no longer there. But there's no place to like put that on applications. And then, you know, then there's the one experience where I left one of my jobs for grad school and they weren't very happy about that. So that kind of burned a bridge. So how do you handle situations like that then, when it's not a matter of you getting fired, but it's just either the person no longer
the truth.
Works there? Just the truth?
Just the truth. So when you're working, you know, always link with your manager. Always connect to your manager. I told this to my boys all the time. Whoever you work for in whatever internship, invite them on LinkedIn. And when you leave your internship, if you can't get rehired because they don't do that or whatever reason you don't want to go back, ask them for an endorsement on LinkedIn. Right? They'll never take that away. It's your personal endorsement. No matter if you burn a bridge or not later, it's there in perpetuity. You got a digital footprint of someone saying nice things about you. And it happens to be your manager. If you have a coworker, a customer you supported while in that internship, get their endorsement. Think about your footprint, your shadow that you're creating in this space and make it yours. Right? And so it doesn't matter if this person's frustrated with you that you went and got grad school, you have these other endorsements that you can rely on and say, yeah, they didn't like me leaving. I committed to my education. This is what I did. People know that happens.
But no. Does that automatically filter you out when you're applying to jobs online?
No.
If you say, no, you can't contact, or if you, you know, just leave it blank.
Because, just leave it blank.
Because there's oftentimes just like a checkbox, you know, rather than writing out a please spec.
Just leave it blank.
Okay.
The recruiter will ask you later what your references are when they matter.
Okay. So then just approach that whenever you're talking directly with them.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
How much of a disadvantage is having work and internship experience from overseas only with candidate?
It depends on what you're learning that you're trying to achieve, right? So if you're overseas, again, the industry, the perspective, the macro view of the economy, what is it that you learn and how can you apply it to the bigger global view will help translate. If it's so localized experience overseas in Vietnam, you know, people here won't understand what you learned. It's like going from the armed forces to a private company. It's hard to translate. So your responsibility is to translate for them. So by working internationally, you learn to work in a diverse workforce with multiple language and cultures. You learn to solve problems and rely on others in multiple time zones. You learn to blank, right? Europe is 10 countries in like XYZ complexity with so many different labor laws, like understanding how to navigate that is a gift, right? Yeah. How do you showcase what makes you great by this international experience?
Like, when they're reading your resume before, like getting to know you, giving you a chance to see you and get to talk to you, they'll never, like, from the paper, know how really good you are.
That's why you have the summary in the LinkedIn profile. You've got to tell them how good you are. You got to brag. You do. You have to brag a little bit. I have learned to master the following things doing 3 international stints. I love to learn and can't wait to translate those skills into a U.S. domestic company. Make a bold statement so a recruiter's like, wow, they took this rich experience and want to apply it here. You've got to tell your story, right? The you know, what I did in XYZ company is nice and that's facts. But in your objective statement on a written resume and or your summary statement on a LinkedIn-like profile should be compelling about your personality. It should be your story.
And do you think like it can decrease from your chances of getting your voice heard or getting out into the field and making connections?
It depends on what they're looking for. It's not a guarantee, but I'll give you a trick. When I'm applying for a job or when I'm teaching students, millennials, how to apply for a job in a space they have yet to work for, they're trying to enter a new market, I tell them to spy on people virtually that have done that job on LinkedIn or other spaces and learn their language and how they sold their skills. Because what a marketer says about what they did and how they did it is different than an HR geek, is different than a financial geek. And I kind of shadow them a little bit and modify my profile to feel more like them. I could become more chameleon-like. So if you have an appetite to work for a company that's domesticated, that is in the finance space, is nothing what you do there, look at those types of people, research them, and copy their language the best that that relates to who you are, but is language that will be captured by a recruiter and best understood. It's a nice trick. You're welcome.
You brought up endorsements, so I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about the importance of those, kind of the etiquette around them, and I mean, how important, how serious are they taken, really?
The basic endorsements, like great project management skills, blah, 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 they're nice to have, not imperative. The ones where someone takes time and writes a paragraph about you, those are critical for new time employees. Like, I'm still mad at my son for not getting his done last summer. I'm like, what were you thinking?
I guess he'll get it.
Get it now before Martin forgets who you are. Get it now. Get him to write three sentences. I don't care what they are, because that is rich gift. That is more important than the money you made this summer, is that endorsement. Right? So get those, because I will not extend, this is why this is so important, I will not extend my personal reputation and professional reputation for you unless I 100% believe in it and believe in you. Because if they hire you and I lied, then I am bad. And I will not extend the risk of my future earnings on you unless I believe in you. So as soon as I put my words on your behalf, the credibility is 10x. Versus the menu, program management, leadership, change management, blah, blah, blah. Make sense?
And does that extend to people that work under you, right?
Yeah, everything. Okay. No human being will refer you and or write about you unless they're willing to commit for you and that you help them. So I will not refer people in LinkedIn unless I think they're of higher quality. That's a slam dunk. Because I want my reputation of identifying talent to be stellar. So I don't give it away often. And I'm teaching my children how to do that. And you guys should learn, I should tell you this too. Here's what I tell my sons. They play football for Chapman University. One's in business, one's in biochem. Their friends have seen that a couple of their friends have gotten internships at LinkedIn through them. And now I've gotten a rush of people connecting with me from Chapman. And I'm like, this is awesome.
This is what I'm...
Yeah, but I know these kids, but I know some of these Chapman kids, right? And so what I started doing day one is taking this name and going to my son Ben and Eddie. I said, Ben and Eddie, this guy named Anthony so-and-so says they know you, and he's trying to connect with me on LinkedIn. Their first reaction was like, whatever. And I'm like, whatever? What do you mean by whatever? And they go, why do you care if I know him or not? And I'm like, he's on my team. Is he good, bad, or indifferent? Does he show up on time for practice or not? And does he treat you with respect and the coaches with respect? Well, damn. And I go, I want to know. And they go, why? And I said, because if they don't do that, I'm not accepting their invite. So you are the gate to their network. And they're like, oh. And so they had to think about it. And they go, like, Tony's good. Not so much this person. And it impacts the network. So I'm teaching them the power of you agreeing to do that. That's super, super important. It's changed careers for their friends, the ones that they've helped.
Hi. So most executives and the top in the company are very down-to-earth and very gentle. So if we invite them for a meal, most of them are willing to chat with us. But the problem is that after having a meal with them, and maybe we don't have a chance to work for them or do something for them, how do we maintain this connection positively?
That's a very good question. Mm-hmm.
How do I say this nicely? So a lot of executives get overwhelmed, both for job opportunities and downturns like in 08. People got flooded. I need a job, right? I want to take you to lunch, coffee, this, that, and the other thing. And it's always with help me attached to it, right? And as an executive, your time and your capital is very, very limited. And so you've got to help the executive and have respect for the executive as much as you want them to help and respect you. And so when people want me to mentor them and they want me to meet with them every other week, it's all about them. What they should say is that if you can spend one day a quarter with me, I will come prepared, I'll have my homework, I'll have a pointed question, I'll show you what I worked on, you know, and I will, if I don't need the full hour, I'll give you the gift of time back. That shows me great respect. But if you pull from me, I will be more likely to push people away. And so executives have learned over time not to get all their time sucked up. So if you want a healthy relationship, ping them for no reason at all other than to say hi. Ping them because you thought of them, you saw something about their company in the news, good news, not because their stock dropped, and say, hey, congratulations on the product launch, reminded me of the dinner, hope you're doing well, I still thought about the one thing you taught me, blah, 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 hope our paths cross again. Boom. That's classy. That's classy. Don't always ask for something. There's people that come up in 10 years, I haven't heard from in 10 years, but because they go, hey, I haven't talked to you in 10 years, but I need a job and I lost my job, I'm willing to help them. If they reach out in 10 years and go, oh, how's it going? How's your kids? Like three paragraphs down, oh, by the way, do you know I got laid off? I need a job. It's fake, right? How you communicate is important. But when you're establishing your first relationship with a connection, don't make it all about you. Just keep it soft and warm, right? Don't demand anything. Let them know you're thinking and remind them who you are. Because when you send them a note and they read it, they will read it, by the way. They'll glance. They may not have time to respond, but your name will pop in their memory. And that's a good thing. So when you do apply, I found a position in your company. I am super excited to work for your company. They will know who you are. And then so make sure you talk to Annie. Right? And Annie, I just talked to so-and-so James, and he said I could talk to you, and then it feels warm, right? It doesn't feel like you've been using them along the way, because for executives, it's very hard not to use your lose your capital. Does that make sense to you?
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question for a significant portion of our students, not necessarily all of them whom are here, but we have a lot of students who come from international. And they can work and get paid for a year after they finish their master's degree. And most of them want to work at least for that year, if not for a little bit longer, before they go back to their home countries. And as you know, that's a challenge because you get an entry-level person for a year and they're finally maybe not making as many mistakes and then it's my visa's up. And so one of the things I always encourage them to do is look for companies that are Chinese companies and working here, or companies here that want to go into China. A lot of our students are East Asian. But do you have any better suggestions or ideas and things that they can, they might be able to do?
I think the multinational route's a great one that have offices around the globe. So do your homework for that so you can always transfer. Don't set up, false expectations. So if you only have a year, you only have a year, right? If you're going for the quick win and the experience, I'd suggest that you look for projects and or work that gives you quick cycle times, meaning sales, recruiting, operational things, projects that can be done in less than a year is what you should apply for, because that implies they're easy to learn. It's a quick cycle time, repetitive. It's a skill set and experience you can take with you when you leave, right? It doesn't take as long to learn. You get your feet planted in 9 months and then you're gone. That's kind of like a bummer. Like, I'd hate that, right? So multinationals, I think, is if you really want to grow with the company, great way to do it, or those quick cycles. Contract work is also really good. Visa, that's hard sometimes with the contract work. So if you get a sponsor, you can do it.
Any other questions for her on that topic?
I have to think more on that one. That's a good one. What else?
And I used to be like hiring millennials, and you love millennials, but what about somebody like me who's not a millennial and somebody who is a non-traditional student and I'm looking to change career paths? How would you look at somebody like me who has a few more years than most of the students in here?
You have the persona of a millennial. So what people and companies are recognizing are attributes of a millennial. The millennials actually, if you disaggregate it, probably three generations in one label. They're early families, they're mid-30s to 18, 19 years old. There's a lot going on in that spread, right? So that title is about curiosity, taking risks, being open, being very clear about balance of life and what you want, and purpose-driven. There's some attributes of a millennial-like mindset that is being embraced beyond that generation. I think I have more of a millennial mindset than a baby boomer, right?
Huh.
All right there. We'll talk later. And so I think that what you want to showcase is the agile learner adaptability. There's a lot of work being written now about the digital world and liquid workforce. So about 2 weeks ago, Ellen Shook, the CHRO of Accenture, and the CTO co-wrote a piece on the liquid workforce and how Accenture is helping companies like GE reinvent its workforce, retool its workforce, how tools, the applications we use, the enterprise systems we use, how we do our jobs are changing because of the technology that's being infused into companies and actually changing the job you do. Jobs are being eliminated by technology, we always knew that, but you know, the tool you use is changing, so you have to relearn. It's like the TV controller pisses me off. Every time my husband gets a new Comcast Infinity, I get a new controller. It's like, I don't know how to work this one. Just, you know, volume on off. That'd be like it for me. So technology is invading the work and the home. And if you're an agile learner and you show curiosity and constant learning, you're attractive as an employee.
And how would I compete for a position with somebody who's, say, 24 to 25 years old, and I have 10 plus years experience or years on them, and we might have the same amount of experience? How would I compete? I mean, because
you emphasize the current experience that you're competing with, right? So you can weave your story. Like on LinkedIn, if you had 10 jobs, of which only 4 are relevant, because the other 6 were your prior personality, you know, I used to be this, now I'm this, you make those 3 or 4 jobs bigger, bolder, better. You know, your decision to go to grad school, pop it, your story, care less about your age. It's about what your journey is. And then the other jobs, make a one-liner, right? De-emphasize that, show the journey transition.
For somebody like her who's switching, and I don't know that that's true for you, so so might be applying for a job that might be lower level than what she had before, when she had, you know, where that's where her experience is. And so what happens, at least what I hear back from our grads is, you know, I'm applying for a junior, maybe not an entry level.
Yeah, you're overqualified.
And I'm overqualified, but I can't come into a more senior job because I have no track experience in corporate.
I'm underqualified on that.
So how do you solve that double bind?
How I would personally do it is really through relationships, right? Get advocates and buddies in the industry that you want to enter in and have them advocate on your behalf to get you the experience that you need, right? I would just index on that. You have a higher EQ and seasoning than your competitors. Use that to your advantage. Be more open and transparent about your retooling your skill set, and so compensation, you understand it's a lower pay or a different title. What you're aiming for is this thing over here that's brilliant and shiny in your mind, and you take away some of that angst. If you have a junior level recruiter, it's gonna be a harder story to sell because they go, oh, she won't be happy, she'll leave in a year. They pattern recognize good or bad, and that would be bad for you. That's why if you have an advocate in the company that speaks with you, it's a better entry.
Thank you.
When you are looking through cover letters, what are the things that you really look at for, and would you be looking for us as new graduates to be touching on our education in that as well?
What do I look for? The things that get my attention now is when someone says what they're gonna do for me lately. You know, Pat, let me come in and do, you know, diversity and inclusion for the company because I have an idea that hasn't been done and LinkedIn takes risks and here's my thinking and I've got so much excitement and passion, let's have a call. I can't wait to share with you my ideas. Like, give me something like that in a letter, not just say, I've worked for Apple, I've worked for, you know, The Gap, and you know, the typical stuff that doesn't get my attention as much. I'd like to see on a cover letter that they've done a little bit of research on the company and why this is a good fit for them. Okay. Right, a little bit more spark of personality. You're less found, unfortunately, by mailing and cover letters than you are by the digital footprint and an email and a connection from somebody. If you can send an email to your buddy that works for the company and have them refer you into a job, the chances of you being seen are 10x. And then you can begin positioning what you do for the company and why this is great for you. And people get referral bonuses, so it helps them, it helps you.
And then would you want us to, if you were receiving an application from a new graduate, would you expect them to touch on their education in it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And why you chose the school, right? So USC is a great brand, right? So you get uplift from USC, full stop. But you have to tell me is why you chose USC besides the brand. Like, what was it about USC and the richness and the connection that you've gotten here, and why does it really matter to you? Like, did you take advantage of it? It's like what the professor says, like, did you go to alumni networks? Did you take advantage of all the resources? Have you built that network? Does it show in your LinkedIn profile? Boom. Like, just don't do the typical ladder, because you'll look like everybody else.
Okay. So when you're doing like all of these things, right, that ideally we'd include in something like a cover letter or in the summary, how do you make that into just one page? So like when explaining your experiences, right?
You don't have to do one page anymore.
I guess you can like expand it. So, but for instance, like what is an average length of something that you'd be like willing to read? Does it not matter as long as it's like engaging and entertaining?
Entertaining is a good value. I'd say grab my attention in the first paragraph.
Okay.
Grab my attention. And then remind me when you close off why you grabbed my attention. Okay. And in between, maybe facts. Because when you close off, I remember why I looked at you to begin with. I'm like, oh yeah, I like her. Boop, move her to the side. You know, I'll follow her up. And when you're applying for jobs, and it's so hard to coach so many people, but they go, Pat, I just saw on LinkedIn a product marketer, sales ops, comms partner, someone in finance and recruiting. I'm applying, can you recommend me? I'm like, dude, really? You think you're gonna crush all these five roles, and why these five roles? Like, something fit for them. Tell me what fit for you and stack rank them. Give me an idea, a heat map of why you think you fit something so I can best help you. Just don't do a scattergun because you're just looking for a job. Because that's what it feels like. I just need a job. And then you're less attractive.
Does it make you look desperate? And that, okay. So even if there are a couple roles then at a company that...
But say why. Stack rank them. I couldn't believe I found three jobs at LinkedIn that I think got my excitement up. Normally I find one, but Pat, I have to tell you, these three jobs rocked my world for these reasons. Mm-hmm. And why I think I'm great for you is these two.
Okay.
And ask, you know, I've got great references, amazing experience, and an appetite for learning that's bar none. You can reach me at blank. I'm like, wow, damn, she's confident. She's clear. All right, let's go.
Okay.
All right, but be clear. Like when they do scattergun, and it's like, you're giving the ownership to the recruiter to find out how you fit. Big mistake. They're prioritizing your behalf. What if they pick the wrong one? Big mistake. Mm-hmm. Then you're grabbing the barrel wherever it lands. That's lack of control.
So it's better to be highly selective and submit fewer applications than to kind of shoot in the dark and apply for a bunch.
You can apply for a bunch. Just in each time you apply, be clear about where your passion lies in each one of those.
Okay.
Right? If it's a downturn, I'll apply to 100 different companies, but show my passion uniquely in each one, how I'm amazing for that company. Right? But show your homework. Just don't say job number ABC, title X, Y, and Z. I think it fits my skills. Please look at my profile. Because then the recruiter's like, all right, I have to do the research. Mm-hmm. Okay. And they can be lazy. I love them. But we, you know, they're processing a lot. Yeah. Other questions? Yes?
I had a question about organizational culture. And you're kind of like,
there's a lot there. Let's go.
Talk about. But kind of over all the different companies you worked in, do you notice whether you sort of excel in a particular work
in a particular org culture, or have you seen various org cultures that work as opposed to just one? And also, when you go in to do HR, do you kind of try and mold your organizational culture to fit you?
Yes and yes. I believe I've excelled at every company, and even the culture I didn't fit, I figured out how to excel. And I was very deliberate in my thinking about why I was there. And I am one resilient person. So even if I have a bad manager, I'm okay. You might suck. I'm okay. I'll navigate it. I'll learn. I'll learn what not to do. I'll learn how to manage up. I'll learn how to make my work work, because I need the job. I need the experience. I need to be resilient. All those things. The best motivation I ever had was from a female leader. She was a director of HR, semiconductor industry, tough industry, but she turned to me and I got an amazing review, like from 1 to 5, I got a 5 rating, best rating ever. And she said it was because of my customers that forced her to give me this rating. So she was kind of annoyed that she had to give me this rating. I'm like, you think that you'd be happy? My customers are happy, and I work for you. You're like, halo effect, you'd be looking good, I'm looking good. No, she's mad. And she basically told me that I need to be more humble, that it would, she doubts I'll ever become a director of HR, that I am too aggressive in my career, that I need to pay my dues, because I was a manager. I just got promoted to manager, and she was a director. And she just supplied that I was capped in my career and I didn't deserve the rating. So I sat there and I absorbed it, and I thanked her very much. I was very, very, very appreciative of what she said. Do you know why? No, because it was a catalyst in my thinking that no one's judgment of me will define who I am, but what I feel that I can do. And she just kicked my ass to exceed her faster than even I thought I should. Like, not only will I be a director of HR, I'll be a better one because I know what not to do. That I will treat people beautifully because they deserve it. That this bullshit you just played on me won't be played in my world. And that I won't put limitations on my children or on people that work with me. That I only guide you while I have you. And that I will be, you know, the best HR leader and run HR someday, and thank you for this life experience. And she stayed a director of HR. She never got promoted from that level. So I thought it was a good catalyst to kick my ass a little bit. Women are our worst advocates sometimes. That's changing, but when I was growing my career, we were not helpful of one another. We're very competitive. It was not good. That's changing. Questions in the back? Any questions back there? I don't want to ignore you guys.
Since no one's asking, I had this question. I wasn't sure how important it is, but I just...
It's all important.
I just wanted to know if you could share with us some of the most interesting, since you've seen so many resumes, some of the most interesting resumes that you've come across. Not talking about somebody who's outside the bell curve, somebody who's probably average but had some good skills, something that person did that
Bless you.
Set them apart from the other candidates.
So I have had a couple that were really awesome. So someone that played in my ego in a very smart way. Yeah, I was growing as a leader. I was learning how to speak and present, and they saw me speak publicly. It was like one of my few first public things. And I mentioned it in the speech and jokingly said, give me feedback afterwards, like if I can make this better for you, because I'm speaking for you, let me know. And, you know, I want to get good at this. If I continue, and if I suck, tell me, and I'll never get on stage again kind of attitude. And this candidate was in the audience and wrote me an email and a formal letter both, and said, I saw you present. These are the two things I learned. These are the two feedback. You asked for feedback. Here's two feedback for you. The first one is you should hire me. I would learn a lot from you. Number two, hire me tomorrow. I need a job today. And so I called him up and I hired him. Because he was so honest and like, I need a job. He saw me. He echoed what he took away, two salient points. His writing was clear and crisp. He had a little bit of humor, Like, hell, who wouldn't want to work with that, right? I like that. I liked it a lot. The other one was, that got my attention, didn't really like HR, but they liked how I was building the team. They liked what they saw. And they were willing to risk themselves to follow me in my function and leave sales for these reasons. And they would be the best advocate by showing how great the function is and all this. And so because I love my function so much, I wanted to take the risk, you know, with them. I'm like, yeah, come on into my function. I'll make you the biggest fan and advocate you ever saw. And so together, you know, she ended up being amazing as well. So when you show why you want something, when you show a little bit of humor and humility, how you add value, you get my attention. I don't want too much formality. I don't want too much words about how, you know, what you learned and what you, I can get that from your resume. You get really quick at that, you know? And I want to know what your biggest mistake was and what jumps you out of bed, right? I think I'd jump out of bed an hour early every day if you would hire me, because I'd be so excited to come in. Done. You know, come in. Not that I want you to work so many hours, but just the joy of working and helping me do great stuff would get me excited to work with you. That's the kind of thinking I want and energy around me. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Those are things that grab my attention. Or that the company industry was such a unique space that they saw it and they want to go there because they can see how it changes lives and it's aligned with their purpose and they're so committed. I love that feeling, because I want to build a great place. I want to treat people beautifully. I think work is an amazing ecosystem of humanity. And so when humanity shows up in how you reach for a job, it resonates with me.
To wrap up pretty soon, because I know they all want to talk to you, but I have two requests.
Yes, ma'am.
One, would you talk about humanity in the organization and bringing humanity into corporate culture? And then would you give them the one last piece of wisdom that we haven't thought enough to ask for?
Wow, we were very thorough today. I'll think about it on the plane going, darn, I had some wisdom. I left it on the table. Humanity. So I don't think that, I don't want to be careful how I say this. I think companies would be more amazing if they unleashed discretionary effort in their workforce. To unleash your passion, your discretionary effort, means I have to connect with you at a human basal level. I have to know you. You have to trust me. You'd have to want to follow me. I have to speak language and words that you understand. I don't have to showcase a vocabulary that's in some book. I don't have to show you an algorithm just to show you I'm intelligent. I have to show you that I care about you. I have to show you that I'm there for you and I am consistent in my beliefs and I'm fair in treatment. When you do that in an organization, you unleash a compelling workforce that will follow you to amazing distances and do amazing work. And so I try to lead that way. I try to bring that to my personal team. I try to bring that to the companies and the culture in which I work. And I do that with intentionality. So companies have values and vision, right? You hear culture all the time. I like to call my boss, the CEO, out on the carpet a little bit and my peers about, do you really mean what you say? Because you can say stuff and not really behave that way. Right? It's walking the talk. You've heard it all the time. But I do it intentionally. So at LinkedIn, when I started, we had act like an owner. Every company has that integrity, you know, open, honest, and constructive. And so I said, I want to write an employee value proposition. What does it mean from an employee's point of view to work at LinkedIn? How does this manifest itself inside the company and out? How does the employee look up and believe in us? So let's go through the values. I'm like, yeah, let's do it, because they were so cocky about their values. I'm like, show integrity, no brainer. I'm sure we don't break the law. You know? I said, but let's, what about open, honest, constructive? And I purely set them up on this one. Well, Jeff Weiner's like, I am so open, Pat. I have an all hands every other week in the company, globally. I talk about it and I tell about the company, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm like, yeah, you do. I love that. And so you're open. And yeah, we talked to employees about what's happening in the market and the product and the finance. This is all great. And I said, awesome. So this is where it was a softball. How many of you guys have performance reviews? I had 10 leaders around the table. All 10 raised their hands. I said, great. How many of you guys have a rating system? Now, I knew they had different rating systems. They were not aligned yet, and that's a whole different story to tell you at another time, how to align a company and build a culture that can scale. But they were disjointed. But they all had a rating scale, either 1 to 10, 1 to 5, ABC, didn't matter. And I go, keep your hands up. How many of you guys tell the employee what their rating is, their grade, whatever you want to call it? Every hand went down but one. So I walked up to that whiteboard, and I erased open, honest, and constructive. And I said to the team, I said, that makes my life so much easier. If I get like three values, it's easy to communicate. And that really upset them. I don't know why. What do you mean, why are you upset? He goes, don't erase that, Pat. What are you doing? We're open, honest, and constructive. We had a great debate. And I'm like, but you're not. You're selectively open and honest and constructive. And I don't like selectivity, so you're really not. So yeah, let's just take it off the table. And he goes, no, we are. And I said, then if you have a rating, you have to tell. Do we agree? And they're like, we agree. And I said, anything that impacts the employee's life while at work, they should know that influence their career path and their success and or failure. And they go, what do you mean? And I said, if there's a performance rating, a potential rating, how they perform that was negatively perceived and talked about, these are things you must tell your employees so they can correct their course. Absence to do so means you allow them to fail. Is that okay? No, it's not. And I said, so if you want to be open and honest and constructive, that's what it means. Are you willing to do that? And I will teach you how to do it. Doesn't mean you do it day one. I will hold your hand along the way, because to give open, honest, constructive feedback is a hard skill. It sounds easy, but give someone real constructive feedback in a graceful, loving way is hard. But that's what brings humanity in a company. I want you to want to work with me. Remember I said I want to be respected and loved? Without humanity, you wouldn't follow me anywhere. And I solve big, complex problems. And sometimes it hurts people. But when I do it and I give you grace and respect along the way, when I'm firing you, when I'm giving you bad news, we can still part okay. You can still part not feeling that you were demoralized, you lost your confidence. Right? You can handle bad news in a graceful way. That is what is a humanitarian way in which to lead. And you need to teach people how to do that sometimes and hold them accountable. And that's what, you know, I strive to do every day.
That was a perfect ending piece of wisdom. Please join me in saying thank you.
So can I ask a question?
Yeah.
All right. So I love Rebecca. I love the school. You know, fortunately my kids didn't apply, so I have no excuse. But was this useful to you guys? Was this a tidbit? Did you gain a tidbit that you would walk away and do?
Yes.
You did a ton of things. Because if I'm talking, you're not going to walk away and do something different than I have failed to achieve what I wanted. My success was to motivate you to think a little bit different, to take one step different than you've done yesterday. Or validated and gave you more confidence to do what you were about to try to do. That is what I've attempted to do today. So if I achieve that, thank you. Thank you for inviting me.